listening to the KLWN Morning News Watch with Tyler Jones on FM 1017 and 1320 KLWN.
Well, we are just one day away from the Kansas primary, and to break it all down for us, in particular, the Kansas Senate race, it is conservative author and commentator Ann Coulter, who joins us this morning here on KLWN. Ann, good morning to you. Appreciate you joining us here on this Monday morning.
Good talking to you. I lived in Kansas City, Missouri, but as you know, it's very close for a year. I love it out there. And I love your Senate candidate, Chris Kobach. As many of you probably know, I'm a huge supporter of his. Peter Thiel and I was just looking this up through a big fundraiser for him about a year ago. And the reason is, don't listen to, or actually do listen to them if you're a Democrat, the elected Republicans. I was just thinking, you know, no matter what you think about Trump or his positions on anything else, one of the most important concepts he introduced to America is this idea of the swamp. And that is that whether you vote Republican or Democrat, your representative gets to Washington and suddenly it's all about them. They want to make money for themselves. They want the campaign consultant and the big donor money coming in. And I've been really horrified in the past year or so as a lifelong Republican to see that my beloved Republican Party is about 90% shills for big business. That isn't someone like Chris Kobach, very respectable individual. It's actually kind of surprising, given his very impressive educational background, that he's just a principled, you know, pro-American, pro-American farmers and workers, not pro-American Wall Street money and shill Republicans. And if you're a Democrat out there, you may be as surprised as I was to see that so many of the people you thought were your champions are really just on the take. And that's what you certainly get from, sad to say, Mitch McConnell, who just wants to keep giving the Chamber of Commerce whatever they want, which is outsourcing jobs to China and lots of cheap foreign labor replacing American workers. That's why Chris Kobach is such a threat to the Republican power structure. I don't think this is what most of your average Republicans, or much less Democrats, what they think they're voting for when you hear about these various issues. But unfortunately, that's what an awful lot of it is, which is why it's so refreshing when you finally see someone like Chris Kobach come along, who will put the American people first, and not the Koch brothers, not the Chamber of Commerce, not Raytheon. I was really hoping, and if only Trump had been a little more dignified, we might have gotten this, that there would be this sort of a new party that's not a Republican party or a Democrat party. What was striking to me, and I think lost on a lot of people, was how much Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump agreed on the issues, agreeing on trade. When Bernie Sanders first launched his campaign, I don't know if you remember this, he gave an interview with Ezra Klein at Vox, and Klein just, you know, assumed, well, Democrats, socialists, he'll be down with us on mass third world immigration and illegal immigration. He asked Bernie Sanders about illegal immigration, and Bernie Sanders responded, no, of course I'm against it. That's a Koch brothers idea. Bring in lots of cheap workers, pay them $3 an hour. That hurts working class Americans. Now, Trump put it somewhat more aggressively, and the Democrat Party got a hold of Bernie Sanders and said, no, Bernie, we're for mass illegal immigration. But if you really care about the working class in this country and regular people, you know, be careful of the big Democratic Party and big Republican Party. There's something in the water in Washington that ruins them.
So, Anna, I got to ask you, your support of Chris Kobach here, this is a guy that lost the 2018 governor race in a red state. He lost the 3rd District U.S. House race back in 2004 in a red district. You know, he's got a track record of, you know, he lost his voter ID lawsuit. I mean, time and time again, he's lost these big battles. Why should Republicans trust Chris Kobach when the U.S. Senate is at stake here, when Kansas could be the deciding factor in who holds the majority here.
Well, it is. I'll give you three reasons quickly. One is, this is just a statistical point, although Kansas has gone back, I mean, maybe you can explain this to me, back and forth on governors, including elected very conservative governors, and then very conservative Republicans, and then very liberal Democrats. As your listeners, I'm sure, know, Kansas hasn't voted for a Democratic senator since, what, around 1936? Point two, I'm not sure Marshall or Hamilton, who's much farther, is a fabulous fellow, but he's much farther down in the polls. And I love Hamilton, but let's be realistic about this.
Sure.
The polls, he's not close. This is a race. This has come down to a race between Marshall and Kobach. I wouldn't think Marshall is you know, your path to the promised land either. I mean, thanks to in large part a lot of ads. By Hamilton, we know that Marshall is exactly what I'm talking about. He's been ridiculing the idea of a wall on the border as if, you know, a wall is some novel concept. That's never been done before. He ridicules the idea of clamping down on illegal immigration. I think that will, that's not where I think the Republican or the Democratic Party voters are anymore. As for what happened in those races, well, the voter ID thing, that wasn't Kobach's fault. Trump wouldn't let him collect the information. It would have been very interesting, but if the states say, "Oh no, we're not participating. We hate Trump," and Trump doesn't use the federal authority. I mean, we do have a supremacy clause to collect the information. There's nothing that can be done. So that was kind of a setup, and I got to blame Trump for that one. The governor's race, I thought it was a bad idea for Kobach to run then. I mean, he's a very civic-minded individual, but for one thing, an awful lot of his issues, obviously he cares most about Kansas, born and bred there, but a lot of his issues are big national issues. He will be a national player, and Kansas will have a senator to be proud of. And also, again, you know better than I do, he was following Governor Brownback, whom I have never been a fan of, and
sure,
apparently neither were the voters of Kansas. So I think that was a tailwind on him.
Ann Coulter joining us here on FM 101.7 and 1320 KLWN. I look at Roger Marshall's record, and I mean, this is a guy that says he wants to repeal Obamacare, supported the Trump tax cuts, supported President Trump's Muslim majority country immigration ban, pro-life. I mean, all those things are right along the Trump agenda here. I mean, I look at Roger Marshall and compared to Chris Kobach, and if you compare the two, it would seem like that Marshall is on par for the course when it comes to the Republican side and what President Trump wants to push, and you don't have the baggage of Chris Kobach. Why Kobach over Roger Marshall?
It was what I was talking about at the beginning. All these guys sound like they're Make America Great Again when it comes time, when election time comes around. That's why I'd like to see if they're consistent on that. I mean, you don't slip and start denouncing the idea of a wall. That isn't like, you know, a reporter caught you in the hallway and you used the wrong word. Or, you know, you put up a picture of Clyburn instead of John Lewis. That isn't a slip of a tongue. That shows what you really think. And what Marshall really thinks is, who butters my bread? And it is the donors, it is the rich Chamber of Commerce, the ones who want nonstop cheap foreign labor. It isn't the voters. It isn't people who care about America, its heritage. That's a big issue. I mean, the immigration issue, I know it's not as big an issue in a place like Kansas that's been largely untouched, but I think Kansans might want to take note of what's going on in, or has gone on. I mean, California's gone. Because the state that gave us Ronald Reagan, Richard Nixon, gave us tax initiatives. California used to be like Kansas. It would go back and forth between very Democratic governor. You know, there was Jerry Brown 30 years ago, very conservative governor, Ronald Reagan. Well, now, because of immigration, it's the bluest state in the union. No Republican could win an election for dog catcher out there. These are important issues. It is going to change the country and the kind of country you live in, and whether your history is acknowledged or ripped down like all these statues. So, of course, when they're running for office over and over and over again, politicians of both sides, both Democrat and Republican, though only recently the Democratic Party has, I guess there are enough people who don't care about this country now, that the Democratic Party can openly favor illegal immigrants, can openly favor changing the nature of our country by just bringing in massive waves of third world immigrants. But it used to be Harry Reid, Dianne Feinstein, Obama, Hillary, and John Edwards all were adamantly opposed to illegal aliens getting driver's licenses. That was only in 2008. This is a recent development for the Democratic Party. So, as I say, both Democrats and Republicans always run on, no, I'm going to do what's best for you, voters. And then they get in, get a call from Chamber of Commerce. Oh, how many cheap workers do you need so you can throw Americans out of work so Americans can train their replacements at Disney? And now all these tech jobs, we tell poor Americans, major in these American kids, go to college, you got to better yourself. Major in one of the STEM fields, you know, the science, technology, engineering, or math. So these young Americans go off, major in these things, and then, now we're going to be bringing in 800,000 Indians to take those jobs. So good luck to you. We'll up your welfare benefits, your unemployment benefits. No, this is really a crucial existential moment for the country. And I think Kobach will win if he gets the nominee. I think he will be by far the better candidate because there really isn't anything to get him on other than, oh, you lost the governor's race. Well, okay, but he was running in the tailwind of Brown back. At least that's my interpretation of it. I think he's a very impressive candidate. He has the Trump-Sanders issues without being almost kind of a comic figure like Bernie Sanders, or, well, also in many ways a comic and somewhat scary character like Donald Trump. The issues that put Americans first.
Ann Coulter joining us here on FM 101.7 at 1320 KLWN. Recent ad from the Plains PAC has reported Kobach's previous pro-abortion stance back in 2004 from the Kansas City Star. There was some ties to white nationalist groups involving Kobach, dim PACs supporting Kobach.
I can't even let you get through that sentence on the white supremacist. No, come on. There was some field organizer paid $50 to gather signatures. I mean, if that's the level of cancellation going on these days, and as soon as he had posted some stupid stuff, just some, you know, jerk off living alone. Oh, I'll collect signatures. And both Kobach immediately not only got rid of this dopey kid, but fired his campaign manager. What else do you want the guy to do? I mean, that's the kind of cancellation going on these days with people losing jobs
Sure. Because
they retweeted someone else and dropped the white supremacy connections.
Well, with that being said, Ann, let me say this. You have these Dem PACs that are, you know, putting money into Kobach. That's who they want to face, have Dr. Balyeu face in that general election. I look at the state of Kansas, and I think of somebody like Bob Dole, who is probably the most popular politician this state's ever had.
Mm-hmm.
And Bob Dole, I don't see anything in Chris Kobach that even remotely resembles Bob Dole. That, to me, you look at the state.
Oh, I totally disagree.
Really? What do you see? I mean, Bob Dole endorsed Roger Marshall.
Yeah, he
did. What do you see in Chris Kobach that resembles Bob Dole?
Well, Bob Dole is about the only one I'll forgive for endorsing Kobach. He is a party man. That's his thing. That's why he lost in 1996. He was always, Republican Party, Republican Party, whatever the Republican Party wants. And I will say, this is the only one that really made me smile when Republicans idiotically chose to run John McCain, and I said, we're going to lose, we're going to lose, we're going to lose if you run this guy, utterly unprincipled. Bob Dole sent me an email asking me to please support John McCain. That's the kind of guy Dole is. I mean, that one made me smile. He's a party man and loyal in that sense. But I would not take his advice on who is the best candidate or the most principled candidate. And whether they're alike, I mean, other than that factor, what do you care about most? Principle and country, or do you care more about Republican Party uber alles? They are very different kinds of Republicans. I knew that when I worked for the Senate for a while. It was, in fact, I got a Democrat to help me with a lot of the things I was doing because, I don't think this is telling tales out of school. It was, 15 years ago. He was working for Biden, but he only cared. Will the Democratic Party get credit for this? The only thing I cared about was, is this going to be a good policy? And I don't care who gets credit for it. So he actually helped me with a lot of my stuff. There is this division in politics that I think people out in America don't understand that well. Oh, look at Mary Matlin and James Carville. People are always saying, oh, is that a real marriage? Of course it's a real marriage. She's selling Crest. He's selling Pepsodent. Those are not people who are pushing, is this good for the country? So apart from that distinction, Bob Dole being more of a, I'm a party man, and Chris Kobach being more of, I'm an American, I'll take a Democrat idea if it's a good idea, I see them, and perhaps this is because I'm not a Kansan, though as I say, I lived in Kansas City, Missouri, for a year, I see them both as just salt-of-the-earth Americans and true blue Kansans, and decent people, decent human beings in their private lives and in their public lives. So I see them as really deeply Kansan.
And a couple more things before we let you run here. I do want to ask you about the general election come November between President Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden. What do you make of where the race stands right now on that front?
Absolutely no idea. I've been secretly telling my friends, I don't want to discourage people, but I have been secretly telling my friends for the past year, up until about a month ago, he's going to lose, he's losing, Trump is going to lose. Won't say it publicly because who knows, anything can happen. Well, a lot of things have happened, and I mean, he's unfairly hurt by COVID. I think Trump is perhaps unfairly benefiting from all of this crazy Black Lives Matter Antifa business. People will never vote for disorder. You can't have anything. I mean, as a longtime New Yorker, wow, the difference in that city from the Coke Dinkins years to the Giuliani Bloomberg years and now the de Blasio years. You can't have anything if you don't have safety. Once Giuliani dropped the murders from, I don't know, it was a couple thousand a year to, got it down to a few, I think it was about 600 when he left office. Bloomberg, by continuing the policies, got it down to some ridiculous level, 200 a year. I mean, it's a city of more than 10 million people, if that sounds like a lot of murders or lack of murders that I'm bragging about. But once that happened, I mean, the home of the hipsters, Brooklyn, I look at them and think, do you know that under Dinkins, this was no man's land? You could not have set foot in this borough. The way the flowers come back and you can build things like High Line and go through the park, you can't have anything without safety. And I think the meshuggah going on in our cities, the craziness the horror show, that's going, the Democrats aren't separating themselves from it. You would think both parties would be coming out and saying, we got to crack down on this madness. But no, the Democrats are worried about upsetting one segment of their base. And if the choice is between, I mean, I keep saying I've never seen an election, presidential election, where the issue is each side is trying to lose, doing everything it can to lose. So, you know, one day I'll see Trump and think, oh, my gosh, that was stupid and embarrassing. And then the media and the Democrats step forward and, oh, no, we can top that.
Oh, it's fascinating. And we're out of time. Thanks for joining us. I got to tell you, I don't know if you remember this, but the first time I met you, actually, you came to my hometown of Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, back in 2011, and you did a book signing there, and I met you, and you were so gracious, and so it was great to reconnect once again, and you're welcome back anytime. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Great to talk to you. Go Kobach.